Okay. All right, so this experiment you are going to do next is about analog to digital converter. And along the way, you will also learn about something called 555 timer. Okay, so we will see what that is. So let's start with, are you all familiar with binary numbers? Yes or no? Binary numbers. You are all familiar? Okay, let's just do a quick example to begin with. All right, so there are various number systems. The number system that we normally use is called the decimal system, or what is the other name for the decimal system? What is the other name for the decimal system that we use? Anybody? Huh? What is the name for, another name for the decimal system that we use? Huh? Base 10, correct. So base 10, what does it mean? In base 10, a number like this, okay, 567. This means 7 times 10 raised to 0, 6 times 10 raised to 1, 5 times 10 raised to 2. That is how it is, base 10, and that is the our decimal. So similarly, in binary number system, the base is 2, not 10. So therefore, a number like this, and see this, in the decimal system, the digits will go only from 0 to 9. There is nothing after 9. Similarly, in the binary system, the digits will go from 0 to 1. So there is only two digits, 0 and 1. Okay, that's why, that's because it's base 2. So a number like this will be 1 times 10 raised to 2 raised to 0, 0 times 2 times 2 raised to 1, 1 times 2 raised to 2, etc. Okay, so this number, if you do all these additions, it turns out to be 45 in the, in our normal decimal or base 10 system. Okay, are you all familiar with this? This is probably a repetition for you. So what we say is this number 101101 in base 2 is the same as 45 in our base 10 or the decimal system. Okay, if you have n bits, how many numbers can you make up? You can make up 2 raised to n numbers. Okay, because each bit can take either 1 or 0, so therefore 2 raised to n numbers. So if you have 3 bits, if you have 3 bits to represent your numbers, you can make up 8 numbers and so on. Okay, is that clear? Anything that is strange? Okay, fine. All right, so now the question is, why do we bother about binary numbers, or why do we bother about converting from, what is analog? Analog means real numbers, like 1.23 volts. What is digital? Digital is a binary representation of that particular number or voltage. Yeah. So first of all, why bother with digital numbers? Say that aloud. Easy to manipulate, easy to add. Okay, that's one. Right? Huh? It's well defined. I'm not so sure whether this is. It's well defined. So is 1.257. No, it's well defined also. Huh? It's not subject to noise. Okay, that makes some sense. So we will come back to this point. So it's not subject to noise as much as an analog signal is. So that is actually a valid answer. What else? Anybody else? Easy to store, of course. It's extremely easy to store. And that is why we have this, the whole computer revolution is based on digital chips, right? So now we have a storage of gigabytes and so on. And when the first calculators and computers came, the storage was of the order of kilobytes. So now, of course, we have gone like six orders of magnitude in that. So very easy to store. What else? Anybody else? Any other advantage? Anyone? Why only answers are coming from this first two rows? Anybody else? No one has any opinions? What else? You've exhausted all possibilities? Okay, so we'll see. These are the main things. There are some other advantages. Let us look at those. All right, so I have a slide here called Why Digital, right? So as you said, it's very easy to design things. Okay, if you want to add, multiply, do some more processing, it's very easy to do design with digital. You're not doing that in this course, but it turns out to be extremely easy to do this as compared to analog. Easy to store, because you have to just store 0 or 1, and that turns out to be very easy to do. One big advantage of making things digital is that things can be programmed, right? Suppose you, in the analog domain, you do a particular operation, okay, like, for example, filter. You have done last time a filter, right? So if you have an RC filter and you want to change its cutoff frequency, what will you do? You will change the resistor or the capacitor, right? So you'll have to actually pull out one component, put another component. That is not always possible. In the digital domain, if you implement a filter with in the digital domain, all you need to do is to reprogram it in some way. And then you can use that as a with a different cutoff frequency. It's less vulnerable to noise. This point was actually brought up by you also. It is much less vulnerable to noise, and we will see why that is in the next page. And another very big advantage with digital circuits is that you can integrate a large number of functions on a single chip. Okay, for example, your mobile chip has got a huge number of functionality inside. Okay, and most of those things are digital. Of course, there are some front end which is analog and so on, but a lot of processing actually is digital. That. So all these are advantages, and that is why we need to convert. We would like to convert an analog quantity into a digital quantity. All right, so we said that digital a digital signal is less vulnerable to noise. What do we mean by that? Here is an example. So here you see, can you see that red signal there? There is a red signal, okay? Or let me just redraw this. So there is a signal like this. Okay, that is the one which you are trying to transmit. How do you transmit a signal? How do you transmit? You might just connect it from one room to another, or you might transmit through an antenna, so on. So there are so many ways of transmitting. But in that process, invariably there will be some interference from other sources, or there will be just plain noise, and the signal gets distorted. Okay. Now, is it possible to remove this noise? To some extent, it is possible because you can pass it through a filter, and you can actually. But so not all of this distortion actually can be eliminated. So therefore, there is definitely a degradation in the signal. The longer the distance, weaker your signal will get. And there is something called SNR. Have you heard of this term? There is something called a signal to noise ratio. Okay. So if you transmit over longer distances or through longer wires, this signal to noise ratio of a signal will degrade. Of course, suppose it's an audio signal, your audio quality will finally get affected. So therefore, you don't want that to happen. So definitely, an analog transmission will have its limitation in the sense you don't want to transmit for too long a distance because the loss of quality is not acceptable to you. All right, in the digital domain, also there is a distortion. So for example, this red one is your original signal. So this is like your zero, this is like your one, only two levels. You don't need to distinguish between, distinguish any further apart from zero and one. As you transmit this, what will happen? This signal might actually get distorted and might get something like this, might become something like this, right? Is it making sense? Pick up some electromagnetic interference or whatever noise, right? Now what I can do is this is the signal I receive. What I can do is I can feed this signal to an element called a comparator. Okay, and I can feed this some reference. Let's say this is 5 volts and this is 0 volts and this is 2.5 volts. Okay, I can feed this 2.5 volts here to the comparator. I can feed this incoming signal to the plus terminal. So what the output would be plus 5 if this V plus, this voltage here, is greater than 2.5 volts. And it will be 0 volts if this V plus, this voltage, is less than this 2.5 volts. So what we are doing basically is by making it pass through a comparator, we are going to restore the original signal. Is that clear? So it doesn't. All this noise actually then does not matter what it was, right? All that matters is whether this signal was above this line or below this line, and therefore I can actually reconstruct this original signal. So if you have a fiber optic connection from Bombay to Delhi or whatever long distance, you will have these things called the repeaters. Okay, so every so many kilometers there will be a repeater, and that repeater will basically restore the quality of the signal. And with a digital signal, you can actually restore it perfectly. Okay, because all you care is for whether it's a zero or one. Okay, and then that is a big advantage of transmission of digital signals as compared to analog. Is that clear to you? if you are, okay, the question is, if I'm using some kind of modulation, then the noise can affect your signal. But still, what you're transmitting is still digital data, okay? So what you're transmitting is still zeros and ones, okay? What you do at the receiving end or at the transmitting end in terms of coding, modulation, etc., that all that is independent. What is going on your fiber optic line is basically just zeros and ones, okay? So whatever we said about this also applies to that. If the noise is so large that the these boundaries get displaced too much, then of course you have a problem. But that is much less likely to happen with a digital signal as compared to the equivalent distortion in the analog domain. Okay, so that is why digital is still a big advantage in that. All right, what are the other reasons to use digital transmission? We have all seen things like this. You have this right in your watch or in your mobile and so on, right? These things are called 7-segment displays. Why is it called 7-segment display? If you count this number of segments, they are 7. Okay, so what it is actually, each segment, so there is a segment here, there is a segment here and so on. Each segment is actually a diode. Okay, and if you pass current through this diode, it lights up. If you don't pass current, then it remains dark. Okay, that is why it is called a 7-segment display. So again, this is driven by a digital signal. Right? So if you have an analog voltage, let's say 1.357 volts, and you want to display it on a meter like this, right? You need to convert all those all that analog value into ones and zeros, which can drive this kind of display. Okay. Finally, this is being driven by ones and zeros. Right? If the signal is zero, then the LED does not light. If the signal is one, the LED lights. So therefore, your analog voltage like 1.357 volts must be converted into some 0001 pattern, etc. Right, and this pattern is fed to this 7-segment displays so that you can actually see this nice display at the output. Okay, it's not quite as simple because there are three of them, so therefore you need some more interface and so on. But essentially, that is the idea. You take analog value and convert it into zeros and ones. That is the analog. This is the A2D conversion that we want to study in this experiment. What is another application where you know, digital domain is extremely useful is an example here. For example, if you are trying to control something, okay, you might have an industrial plant, a chemical plant, or some factory or whatever. So you have a process, and these are your inputs X1, X2, etc. These inputs could be temperature of some furnace. It could be output flow rate of some reactant. And these are the controller outputs. Okay, so these are things that will go back to your, these you can use to adjust some flow rate somewhere, some input flow rate, etc. So that the overall rate is, overall reaction is controlled. Okay. Now, first of all, there are two advantages. One, it is easy to implement these control algorithms using the digital signal processing chips, okay, which are now available for the past like 20 years. Very, very easy to program these digital DSP chips. Second, suppose you're not happy with the algorithm. Suppose you have some numbers in your control algorithm and you want to change that number. Okay, like you see in your RC filter, you have to actually pull out one resistor, put another, pull out a C, put another, etc. In the digital signal processing chip, you don't need to do all that. You just need to reprogram the chip so that your filter coefficients are now different than what they were. Okay, so it's extremely easy to reprogram things if you want to change the algorithm. So that's another big advantage of using digital outputs, digital numbers. Okay, let's now talk about this A2D conversion process. A means analog, D means digital. Now, if you take an ADC, it will have one number which is called the range of the ADC. The range could be from 0 volts to 10 volts. It could be from minus 5 volts to plus 5 volts, etc. Depending on the chip, they will have different ranges. For example, if your measurement range is like 0 to 10 volts, that is the range of your A2D, and the ADC resolution is 12 bits. Okay. So here is an example. So this is your analog voltage is going from 0 volts to 10 volts. And your ADC resolution, that means your output, starts from 0000, all 12 zeros, to all 12 ones. Okay, so that is your lowest value of the, that is the lowest digital number you get, binary number you get, and that is the highest binary number that you get. Is that clear? Okay. So what is the resolution? The resolution is if there is a change only in the lowest significant bit of this number. So okay, this bit is called the lowest significant bit, or the LSB, okay, or the least significant bit. This bit here is called the most significant bit. What is the weightage of this LSB? Always 2 raised to 0. What is the weightage of this MSB? 2 raised to 11 here. Okay. Since we have a 12 bit, since there is 12 bits in all, this the weighting factor of this MSB is 2 raised to 11. Okay. So that explains just the resolution part. So if there are 2 raised to 12 numbers, okay, which are represented by this number, by this binary output, how many levels do we have? 2 raised to 12 equal to 4096. Okay, so we have 4096, the so-called quantization levels. Why quantization? Because it's discrete now, it is not smooth, it's not continuous, so therefore it's called quantization levels. Right? What is each level? What does that correspond to? That corresponds to simply 10 volts minus 0 volts, that is the range of your A to D, divided by the number of levels. Okay, so 10 volts minus 0 volts divided by 4096. Is this calculation clear to everyone? If it's a 4-bit ADC, what will be the resolution? It will be 10 volts divided by 2 raised to 4, okay, which is 16. All right, so a 12-bit is a very good high resolution. So 10 volts minus 0 volts by 4096, which is 2.44 millivolts. So the first number corresponds to 0 volts. The second number, just one change here, corresponds to 2.44 millivolts, and so on. So each one, the next one will correspond to 2.44 millivolts, added, 2.44 millivolts added, and so on, and the final number will correspond to about 10 volts. Some ADCs also allow negative voltages. For example, you might have minus 10 volts to plus 10 volts. Okay. Okay. Any questions so far? Is all everything understood? All right. We are not yet come to how to do this, and we will just briefly describe as to how this is done. But before we do that, Let's just talk about this business of digital transmission. You're not going to do this in your lab, but this is something that is useful to know. Right? This is interesting to know. How do you, you have an analog signal like this as a function of time. How do you convert it, how do you sort of transmit it digitally? There are several ways of doing that, but the simplest, most basic way is like this. Okay? So you sample this analog signal at a particular point T1, then you sample at T2, and so on. So you sample it at uniform intervals. T1, T2, T3, and so on. Now, this sample value here, right, this is the sample value. You convert that using an ADC into a digital number or a binary number. Right? So what does that mean? Suppose you have an 8-bit ADC. So that means this value is converted into 8 bits, whatever, zeros, ones. The next sample will be converted into another 8 bits, etc. Okay, so what is the total number of bits you have to transmit per second? That will depend on how fast you are sampling, right? So the sampling frequency, suppose this interval is, okay, suppose this interval is TS, S for sampling, then the frequency is, the sampling frequency FS, which is equal to 1 over TS. Okay, if, for example, your TS is 1 millisecond, your FS will be 1 kilohertz, right? Okay, so now you are doing this, and you are, at each time, you are sending 8 bits. Okay, so if my sampling rate is 1 kilo samples or 1 kilohertz, what would be, how many bits would I transmit per second? 8 kilobits per second. Is that understood to everyone? So each sample, we have to, basically we are sending 8 numbers, not numbers, bits, right? It's all just 0 or 1. So that is the meaning of, that is the bandwidth. Now this, your actual bandwidth that you need for example, a phone application would be much, much larger than this 8 kilohertz. Why? Okay, let's not talk about human voice. Let's say our signal is just this, and we are sampling at 1 kilohertz. Even then, we'll require a much larger bandwidth. It's simple. That's right. No, multiple bits is just one thing. Okay, what else? Multiple bits is one thing, but thousands of users is another problem. You're not the only one in the world who is talking to some other person in the world, right? There are some thousand people talking to some thousand other at the same time. all of this has to go together. Okay, so therefore this number, and of course there are a lot of other complications, like you need to modulate, you need to encode, you need to etc. So all that makes things very complicated, and that is why the bandwidth of your mobile phone is something like gigabits per second. Okay. All right, so that is the just the general background about transmission. But let us look at MP3. You all use MP3? How many songs do you have on your telephone? How many songs do you have on your telephone? 5 songs. 500? 500. Okay. I'm so shocked that I won't ask any more questions. Okay. So you all know MP3. And how can you store so many songs in one single telephone? Even given that your memory is, quite huge now, huge. And that is because it is not, they do a very sophisticated signal processing to reduce your storage requirement. Okay, so the sampling rate for music, if you are playing MP3, is something like 44 kilohertz. Okay, what is the human range of frequencies? Maximum? 20 kilohertz. 20 kilohertz is very rare. Even Lata Mangeshkar will not actually reach 20 hertz. Something like 15 maybe. So about maybe 15 or something. So maximum 20 kilohertz is like the absolute maximum. Okay. So this sampling rate is not much higher than the highest frequency in your speech signal. So just 44 kilohertz. Okay, 44 kilohertz, and just see the number of bits transmitted per second. It's 128 only. Okay, 128 kilobits per second. It corresponds to just 3 bits per sample. Okay, and 3 bits. Now, if you are just doing this old way, I mean this simplistic way, you will never get a very good quality in the output. So what they do is actually this is, they do some very sophisticated compression of the signal, and then therefore they can manage to store much less information and actually get out the same quality. And that of course is the whole realm of digital signal processing and speech processing and so on. You heard of GSM? If you use a mobile phone, you will know this. There the sampling rate, now this is just speech, okay, this is music. So therefore here with the speech, the sampling rate can be much smaller because you don't really care that much for quality. All you need to know is what that person is talking, okay, whether he's talking sense or nonsense, or what words and so on. Okay, so the sampling rate is much lower than the music signal. Music signal is much more sophisticated. You want to make out the flute from the tabla and whatnot. So here, the sampling rate is just 8 kilohertz. And here again, see the compression achieved. See this. So you're just sending 13 kilobits per second. It's almost the same as this 8 kilohertz, right? So there's not really much difference. Again, this is made possible because you are sending some characteristics of your signal and not the signal itself. Okay? And that is, again, a huge a domain by itself. Okay, so all these things are not included in your experiment, but you should know these numbers. All right, so let's come to how this A to D conversion is done. We will just take two cases. The first one is called a flash ADC, and this is not the ADC that you're going to use in your lab, but it's good to know. This is a very simple one conceptually to understand. So what do we have here? We have a voltage source, let's say 10 volts, and we have a network of resistors. Okay, and if you have 16 resistors, this voltage is simply V0 by 16. The next voltage will be 2 by 16 times V0. The next one will be 3 by 16 times V0 and so on. Right? The last one will be 14 by 16 and then 15 by 16 and so on. Is this understood? This is a simple voltage division. You are all doing E101? Yes? Anyway, this is something you have done earlier. It's just a bunch of resistors in series. And so therefore each of these voltage drops is simply V0 by the number of resistors. And that number of resistors, if it is 16, we have V0 by 16 here, then another V0 by 16, and so on. And that is why these voltages here are marked as they are. Okay. Now what you do is, this is your input voltage signal. Okay, so you feed that to a comparator. There are so many comparators. If there are so many resistors, as many comparators as there are resistors. Each comparator gets a reference voltage from this node, like this. That is different. But it gets the same input voltage. Okay, so this input voltage is going here, is going here, and so on. Okay. So what happens now? If your input voltage is smaller than this quantity, this becomes a 0. If it is larger than this quantity, this becomes a 1. Is that basic idea clear? All it is doing is, this is a simple comparator. It puts out a 1 if the V plus is larger than V minus. It puts out a 0 if V plus is smaller than V minus. That's all it does. It's a, that's why it's called a comparator. It compares. And so therefore, of these comparators, you will have some which are 1s and the rest which are 0. Is that easy to visualize? Okay. Let's say your voltage is somewhere here. Then these comparators will have 1 as the output, or sorry, 0, and these will have 1s. So there will be some 0s and the rest 1s. Then you have a logic which will convert this into the digital output that you want. Okay, so that is a simple ADC. It's called flash ADC because it does things in a flash. It's very quick, okay, as opposed to some other forms of ADC. What is the disadvantage of this? The obvious disadvantage of this? If you have 12 bits, you will need 2^12 comparators, okay, which you may not even be able to fit in one single chip. So that is a problem. But if you want 8-bit resolution, there is a practical, it is a practical alternative. It's very fast because all of these things are getting compared at the same time, and therefore it's fast. The ADC that you're going to use in this lab is actually of a different type, not this flash ADC. Flash ADCs, of course, are expensive. What you're going to use in the lab is called a successive approximation ADC, okay? Successive approximation analog to digital converter. All right, so this is a little block diagram for that ADC. So what it does is there is actually a DAC inside. What is a DAC? DAC is just the opposite of an ADC. So it takes in a binary number, and it gives you an analog value as an output. Okay, so this is the binary number input, and this is your analog output, say V. Okay, now what you do is, so this works on the basis of a clock. Okay, now you apply the first clock pulse. Let's take an example. This is best done by an example. So let's say you have a 4-bit DAC here. That means your ADC is also 4-bit. Suppose you have 4-bit DAC. What is your lowest value? Is 0000. The next one, 0001, 0010, all the way up to 1111. Okay. Now let's say on this scale, your analog voltage happens to be somewhere here, the dotted line. Okay. The first pulse, what this processor will do is it will set this bit, the MSB, to 1, and all the others to 0. Okay. Is that clear? So what happens as a result? The voltage, so this 1000 is now fed to this DAC. Okay, that will produce a voltage that corresponds to this level. Now that voltage and this voltage are compared. Okay, so now it turns out that Vin is still higher than this voltage. So what we do next is we keep this 1, but now we make the next bit also 1. So from here, from this level, okay, this is our trial number 1. In the next clock pulse, we make this 1100. Is that clear? Okay. This is a rather silly example because there are only 4 bits. In actual practice, there will be 8 or 12 or whatever. Okay. So the next bit is made 1. Now what has happened as a result? This analog voltage has now become larger than Vin. Okay. So therefore, what we do is we know that now this should not be 1, so this should be 0. So we make this 0 and make this 1. Okay. At some point, we will hover around the actual analog voltage. Okay, you heard the story of the two cats fighting with each other and a monkey judging the event. Have you heard this story? Who has not heard this story? I'm sure even if you have heard it, you will say you have not heard it. Anyway, so there are these two cats and they are fighting over a piece of khoya. Okay, khoya, you know what khoya is, right? Or whatever, some food item. So now this very clever monkey comes, okay? So it says, so that monkey wants to give this two pieces equally to the two cats, right? So what it says, it makes little, one piece a little bigger than the other, and it puts in a balance, right? Of course, one of them goes down. Then it just takes a part of that and eats it. And then so that this one goes down, so it takes a little part of this and eats it, and so on, okay? So finally, all of that is gone into the monkey's tummy, right? So this is similar. In a way, Do you see the similarity or you don't? Kind of similar. Okay, any questions about this? I mean, not about the monkeys and the cat, but about this. So that is correct. So what he is saying is the voltage will always be between two levels. So then you take the lower one as the output. That is. So you always in this A to D conversion, there is always this business of uncertainty of half LSB. It's called half LSB, half of the least significant bit. That much error will always be there. That is called the quantization error. That is the whole process of digitization. Obviously, you're chopping things off and you don't know where exactly you are. So there is that necessary error there. Okay. All right, so that is what you will be using in the lab. Now, this is, so now the question is how do you generate this clock? So for this purpose, there is a circuit given to you and that is called, that is made using a so-called 555 timer. Okay, so there is a integrated circuit or a chip available called 555 timer, and it has got an input called threshold, it has got an input called discharge, it has got an input called trigger, and you are given the circuit diagram in your handout. I'll just show you the handout. And if you do this, now it's too complicated now in this class to explain how this works, but so we will just take the result. And for us, the purpose of this whole thing is just to feed this clock to your successive approximation ADC, that is all. So you adjust this, you are given some values of RA and RB and C, and then you can, so then this circuit is guaranteed to oscillate if you can make the connections correct. And you are supposed, you will get a square wave as an output with the period equal to 0.7 times RA plus 2 RB, where RA, RB are these resistors, times C. Okay, RC is a time constant, RA plus 2 RB times C. And the frequency is just 1 over T. Okay, so now you are given this some values 1k, 10k, and 0.01 microfarad, and so on. So you calculate all that. The frequency for the circuit that you are given turns out to be something like 6 kilohertz. Anyway, so you are given the values, just do that little exercise and calculate that yourself. So this is simply to feed your ADC. Okay, that is the only purpose it will serve. And the purpose of this experiment is not really to investigate the behavior of this in detail. But what you will do is, to begin with, you will look up the circuit. You will make sure that you are getting some pulses, getting the desired frequency as an output. Then you will use this in the next part of the experiment as a clock to this ADC. So the ADC actually is, this whole thing is the ADC. Okay, all these things that I mentioned, the DAC, the counter, the DAC, the comparator, the processor, they're all inside the ADC chip. Okay, so the clock is one of the inputs of this chip. Okay, any questions about this part? Okay, there is not that much to ask because we have not really covered any details of this. Okay, so now let us look at the little practical details of what you're going to do in the experiment. So let me actually show. Are you all familiar with the breadboard, or you want me to go over it again? Breadboard. Again, are you familiar? Everybody knows. Okay. Anyway, we have got this breadboard again with these components actually connected, thanks to the TS. So we will just see what it looks like, and you can make something similar. It should work. Okay. So there's a chip here. You can see the small chip, the small IC. That is a 555 timer. You see the big chip? It is the ADC. Why is it much bigger than the small, the 555? Why is the ADC? Why does the ADC have so many pins? It needs definitely 8 pins as outputs, right? It is an 8-bit ADC, so at least 8 pins it requires. And then there are other pins. So therefore, it is definitely necessarily bigger than your 555. So let us now look at this pin diagram of the 555. Okay, so this is the first time you may be using this IC, so let us look at this in some detail. So if you take any IC, it will look like this. Okay, so there are 4 pins here. and there are similarly four pins on the other side. So this is looking at it from the top. Okay, there is a notch. Okay, now if you are looking at it from the top, then this pin is called pin number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. This goes with all ICs. Okay, whether it's a 8-pin IC or it's a 16-pin IC, whatever. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, now in this particular case, so we will draw this like that, the top view. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so this is the ground terminal. All of these ICs do not work if you don't connect the supply to it. Okay, so you have to connect supply. Supply means both ground and a supply voltage. So there is this ground terminal. There is this terminal called trigger. There is this number 3 is the output. Number 4 is reset, which you need not connect. Number 8 is VCC. VCC is the power supply, which is 5 volts. Okay. So in the lab, you have this power. You have this AppLab power supply, right? And it has got this terminals here. So you can adjust this voltage to be 5.0, and connect this to this pin. Connect this ground to this pin. That is how you will do it. So these are wires. I'll come back to this wiring. Then the pin number 7 is called discharge. Pin number 6 is called threshold. Pin number 5, control voltage. Okay, so the connections for this particular figure are, I don't know whether you can see that. So the discharge is too light. Okay, still a little light. But anyway, this will be uploaded on the PCs that you're going to use. So you can see the connection in more detail. Okay, but the basic idea is you're going to connect. So basic idea is you're going to make these connections with this chip. And remember to connect the ground and the power supply, otherwise things will not work. Okay, so how do you connect this chip? There's a breadboard. Okay, and you know that these things are connected, these things are connected, and these two rows are not connected. So normally you will just place the chip right here. Okay, and this is your notch. So this is your pin number 1, this is your pin number 2, 3, 4, etc. Is that clear? So you will always place any IC in this slot here. So otherwise if you put it anywhere else, you are basically shorting terminals. Okay, so don't do that. You have to place it in this slot, two sides of that particular slot. Okay, so so each pin remains a separate entity. Okay, then it's a very good practice to designate one of, you know that this is one row, right? There is one connection here. All this is one. Then all this is another contact. And this is a third one, this is a fourth one. So it's a good idea to keep one of these as the power supply or 5 volts. So designate this as a 5 volt line. Designate on the other side, you take one of these columns as the 0 volts or the ground. Okay. So this will go to your AppLab power supply 0 volts. This will go to your AppLab power supply 5 volts. Okay. So that means all of these points are now available to me as 5 volts or 0 volts. Is that clear to you? Okay, you don't need to take wires from each one of these and connect it to your power supply. That is not a way to do that. So just connect one wire from this breadboard to your AppLab power supply, and then this whole thing becomes 5 volts. And all these 5 volt sockets are now available for you to make connections. Okay, so that's a very good practice you must always follow. Okay, the other things are actually fairly straightforward. You've already seen a capacitor before. You've seen a resistor before. So the chip is the only new thing that you're going to use. All right. So the first part, you just make this 555 timer work, and you look at the output voltage of this, and make sure that you get a square wave with frequency of whatever that turns out to be. It comes turns out to be some 0.6 kilohertz or 6 kilohertz, something like that. Okay. Next part is now we are going to use this DAC, so ADC. So let us look at this ADC. There is some documentation on the ADC as well. Okay, and it looks rather forbidding. There are lots of pins, but the pins which are important to us are this DB1, DB2, DB3, DB4, etc. So it starts with DB0. Pin number 18 is called DB0. I don't know whether you can see that. Okay, now you can see it better. Okay, again, this will also be uploaded on your PC. So you can see this DB0, DB1, DB2, etc., all the way up to DB7. These are the digital outputs that you're looking for. DB0 is the least significant bit, or the LSB. DB7 is the most significant bit, or the MSB. It's written also over there. Okay. And then there are lots of pins. Many of them actually you're not going to use. But the important pin that you need to know is V in plus and V in minus. Okay. So your analog input is actually the voltage between this V in plus and V in minus. And in our case, I think we're going to put V in minus as 0. So your analog voltage will go directly into V in plus. A ground and D ground. There are two grounds, analog ground and digital ground, and they should be both connected together and connected to ground of your power supply. Then there is something called V ref by 2. Okay. So if you want a reference voltage of 5 volts, this V ref by 2 should be 2.5 volts. Okay. Just V ref by 2 divided by 2. Okay. All right, so that is that. Then there are these other things called chip select bar and read bar and write bar and so on. So we will, for your purpose, we will tell you where to connect these. So don't worry about those. Then there is something called clock in. Can you see that CLK in, pin number 4? That is called clock in. Okay. Now that clock is required precisely because it's a successive approximation ADC which requires this clock pulses. Okay. So it will require, it will do each one of these comparisons in one clock pulse. Okay, so therefore it needs a train of pulses. And when if it's an 8-bit ADC, after 8 pulses your output is ready. Okay, so in our case, what we're going to do is we're going to connect your 555 timer output to this clock in, and before you know it, your output will be ready, and then it will remain constant because you're going to apply a DC voltage here. You're going to apply a DC voltage as an input. So therefore, in 8 pulses, which is a very short time because the frequency is in the kilohertz range, so you won't even notice it. In 8 pulses, your output will be ready. And how will you test the output now? You can actually take a multimeter and check DB0, DB1, DB2, and so on. See if it is 0 volts or 5 volts, or low or high. That's one way of doing it. We are not going to do it that way. We are going to put some light emitting diodes. Okay, and since there are a lot of connections, we will only test the higher 4 bits. Okay, this is a little tricky. Okay, so what we are going to do is we are going to put these light emitting diodes. Okay, we are going to use these light emitting diodes to indicate whether that particular bit is 0 or 1. Okay, so the way this works is like this. So there is this DB. Where is that figure gone? Okay, there is this DB0, then DB1, and DB2, etc. Okay, so let's say we are going to look at only the 4 MSBs. Okay, that means these, only these 4, right? So, and then the way we are going to do it is we are going to connect a LED here. This red thing that you are seeing is a light emitting diode, and then we are going to put that in series with a resistor, and we are going to connect this to 5 volts. Okay, so when is this LED going to light? If this is high, that is, if this is 5 volts, the LED is not going to draw any current because this is 5 volts, that is 5 volts, no current. If this is 0 volts, right? If this pin is low, then there is a current current will flow through the LED. And this LED will light. Okay. So remember, this LED, the way we are connecting it, the LED will light if that particular output pin is 0, not 1. Okay, just remember, keep that in mind so that you don't get confused while interpreting your results. Any questions? The DB pin is high if that bit is 1, low if 0. Good question. Okay, so okay, let me repeat the question so that everybody understands. The question is, okay, you have all these pins. Let's take one pin, let's say DB7. Now what I am suggesting is you connect it like this so that the LED conducts when this pin goes low. Okay, so what he is suggesting here is, why don't we just connect like this, DB7. Okay, so if this becomes high, the LED will actually light. Okay, which one is more friendly? The first one is more friendly or the second one is more friendly in terms of reading? Which one is more friendly? You would like to see light if something is 1. I mean, just intuitively, at least I would. So the second one actually is a little more friendly to read, because if there is light coming out, you can say it is 1. This is not done because the current that you can draw like this is limited. It has to do with what is inside the chip. Okay, if the current is limited, the LED will not glow brightly enough. Okay, in this case, the current that it can, this is called sinking of current, this is called sourcing of current. So the current that can be sunk by this chip is much larger than the current that can be sourced. Okay, therefore, in all TTL transistor logic chips, you will find this kind of arrangement. I'm not sure. You need to look at this data sheet. It is actually there in your computer. Okay, when you go to the lab, you will see this document also there. Okay, so I think that is briefly the experiment, but let me so these are the LEDs, and you can see an LED and a resistor going to this 5 volt line, another LED, another resistor going to that 5 volt line. If you have time, you should actually connect 8 LEDs and 8 resistors so that you can see all of them, but if you don't have time, just connect the upper 4. Okay, that means DB7, DB6, DB5 and DB4. Okay. Takes all these connections take time, so we will be happy if you just connect 4 of them and look at this. And then you are changing the input voltage from 2.5 volts, 1 volt, whatever values are given, and you're going to look at the pattern here and see whether it is correct or not. You can actually, knowing the resolution of the ADC, knowing the supply voltage, you can actually figure out whether the pattern is expected or not expected. All right, so one more detail that I missed out, and that is, not much better. Okay, there is something called the start of conversion. It's a little tricky. Start of conversion. Okay, so there is a pin. Let me see if I can see this number here. No, this printout actually is not very good. So there is one pin which has to be connected to a switch. Okay. All right, so there's one pin which is called the start of conversion. So when you want to actually, when you change your input voltage, remember to push this switch. Only then the conversion will actually take place. Okay? Even if you have the clock connected, the chip will start functioning only after you press this start of conversion button. And this button will look like this. Can you see this little thing here? This one. Okay? Okay, little square with a button on it. Okay, that is a switch. And that you need to press when you change your input voltage so that your ADC functions. Okay, so I think that is basically your experiment. You have any questions? Anyone? Why do you connect a plus voltage and a minus voltage? Vin plus and Vin minus. The reason for that is sometimes the input to an ADC may come from, a differential amplifier, which has got an output which is like floating. It's not with respect to ground, but it is floating. Okay, so then, but why add to your hardware? No, this will do it, right? Why add to your hardware? So this already is designed for that. So you don't want to increase the cost. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so we'll see you in the lab.